Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this evening episode of Pursue. And this is Pursue 16A, which is Hematology Erythrocytic Disease. And we are streaming live from GMC Kottayam, Kerala via Kolkata. A very basic but very important topic today. We are talking about basic physiology of erythrocyte, the structure, composition, erythropoiesis, and erythrocyte turnover. And to talk on that, we have a very young, vibrant pathologist, Dr. Jaya Priyaji. She is an MD pathology from GMC Thiruvananthapuram, a PDC in oncopathology at the RCC Thiruvananthapuram. Presently, she is an assistant professor in the Department of Pathology, GMC Kottayam, Kerala, with areas of interest in cytopathology, hematopathology, and oncopathology. Presently, she is posted in hematology, so the right person to talk on such a basic topic. Before I ask her to start, let me request all of you to please keep your mic muted, your camera off, and please don't share your screen. With this, let me request Dr. Jaya, ma'am, please share your screen and let's start.
Okay, thank you so much, sir. And good evening, all.
Just press present now, your entire screen.
Yes.
Just tap in the center of the screen and share.
Okay.
Yeah, great.
Okay. So tonight we'll be discussing.
So your PowerPoint, it's full screen. Perfectly fine. Please start.
Okay. So today we'll be discussing the topic erythropoiesis, the basic structure and function of RBCs, and finally the erythrocyte turnover. So before we go into the erythropoiesis proper, just let me share how blood cells, you know, how when, where, and how these blood cells start forming in the body during development. So it occurs in two waves. So initial wave is known as the primitive hematopoiesis.
Voice is breaking.
No, is it? Now? Hello? Hello? Hello?
Hello?
Hello? Am I audible?
Your voice is breaking, Priya.
Okay. Now is it audible? Is it okay? Hello? Hello?
Voice is breaking.
Now is it, am I audible if I start saying?
Yeah, perfectly fine.
Okay, I'm hearing back my sound. Hello? Hello, is it audible? Hello?
Yes, Dr. Priya, I can hear you. Please go ahead.
Okay, wait. I'm not able to see. Okay. So, hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Yes. Okay, so there are two waves in which hematopoiesis occurs in during development. So initially there is a primitive wave that starts around the third week of gestation, and this wave is a very transient wave. It persists for only till the seventh week of gestation. And what is the purpose of this early wave that that occurs between the third and seventh week of gestation is to provide this rapidly growing embryo with the necessary, particularly the oxygen, for that will help in its rapid growth. So the predominant cells that are formed during this primitive wave are the primitive erythroid cells, and along with that, megakaryocytes and macrophages are also formed. And where does this primitive wave occur? It occurs outside the embryo in the yolk sac. The yolk sac mesoderm, progenitors develop into the hematopoietic cells, particularly the erythroid cells, megakaryocytes, and the macrophages. And what's the peculiarity of these primitive erythroid cells that are formed during this primary wave? Unlike the mature RBCs that you see in much of the fetal life and in the adult life, these primitive erythroblasts, they are large cells, around 140 femtoliter in size, and they are nucleated, and they contain predominantly the embryonic type hemoglobins. And unlike the RBCs in the adults, these RBCs complete their terminal differentiation in the vascular network. Now, after this initial wave, there comes the definitive hematopoiesis. Now, this hematopoiesis is what persists throughout the rest of the fetal life and in the adult period. And it starts around the fourth week of gestation. And what is the difference here? All the hematopoietic lineages will be formed during this period of definitive hematopoiesis. And where does this occur? It occurs in two places. One is the liver, fetal liver initially, and then it occurs in the, it is shifted to the bone marrow. So how does it occur? You have the hematopoietic, the stem cells, this hematopoiesis during this definitive hematopoiesis occurs from the hematopoietic, pluripotent hematopoietic stem cells. And how are these, from where does these hematopoietic stem cells arise? By the transformation of endothelial cells lining the yolk sac vasculature and dorsal aorta in the embryo, by the transition to a hematopoietic phenotype. The endothelial cells will undergo a transition into a hematopoietic phenotype and form what is known as the hematopoietic stem cells. So by this time, in the embryo, the circulation is established, and these hematopoietic stem cells, which are formed by the transition of these endothelial cells, will first seed through the circulation into the fetal liver, where it will undergo expansion and maturation. So it will be, the fetal liver will be the major site of hematopoiesis between the 7th and 24th week of gestation. And later on, this hematopoietic stem cells will exit the liver, and finally it will colonize the bone marrow. And that continues through the rest of the fetal life and the adult period. So bone marrow becomes a major site of hematopoiesis after 24 weeks of gestation. So it's shown in this picture. So this is the initial wave occurring in the yolk sac, after that in the liver, and also some in the spleen. And then it is finally shifted to the bone marrow. Now, coming to this is a classical pathway of hematopoiesis that we know. That is, it starts from the pluripotent hematopoietic stem cell, which will proliferate and differentiate into the multipotent progenitor cells, which will further differentiate into this oligopotent progenitor cells. They are called oligopotent because they can differentiate only towards specific lineages, not specific, only one or two lineages. That's why they are the oligopotent progenitors. Now, erythroid progenitors or erythroid differentiation starts from this progenitor, that is a megakaryocyte erythrocyte progenitor. From this oligopotent progenitor, there comes the differentiation and lineage specification into the erythroid lineage. So we'll see which cell the lineage specification starts. This presentation will be concerned with only this limb of hematopoiesis, that is starting from the oligopotent progenitor here to the erythrocytes. Now, coming to erythropoiesis, Now, what is erythropoiesis? Erythropoiesis is the process by which, you know, red cells are formed in the bone marrow in the adults, and in case of fetuses, it will be yolk sac and the fetal liver. So, what is the normal rate in which RBCs are produced in the body? Around, you know, 2.4 million red cells are produced per second. And by that way, you know, the red cell mass in the body is remains a constant. And this entire red cell mass in the body is known as what we call as the erythrone. Okay, that is, the entire red cell mass is considered to be a single organ, and it is called termed as the term erythrone. Now, so where does this erythropoiesis occur? Now, this is where the hematopoiesis occur. Now, you know, in a child, in an infant less than 1 year of age, all the bones in the body will be, you know, hematopoietic. That is red marrow, to be filled with red marrow, or it is hematopoietic marrow. Now, as the child grows, by childhood, the percentage of red marrow starts decreasing and it gets replaced by adipose tissue. So, the percentage of red marrow goes on decreasing, and by adult age, the hematopoiesis will be restricted to very limited sites in the bone marrow, in the skeleton. So predominantly, it is the skull, the vertebra, the sternum, the ribs, the scapula, the pelvis, and the proximal femur. Now here you can see the, you know, cross section of femur. You can see that the red marrow is restricted only to the proximal portion. Now coming to the erythroblastic island.
Just make
now,
it full
this
screen.
Is the fundamental.
Just make it full screen, please. Great. Thank you. Sorry.
Okay. Am I audible?
Absolutely clear. Absolutely.
Am I audible? Okay.
Yeah, you can leave the microphone down. It's perfectly fine. We can hear you clearly.
Okay.
Yeah, relax. Yeah.
Now coming to the erythroblastic island. Now this is the anatomical unit, fundamental unit of erythropoiesis. So what do you see there? You have a central macrophage with adherent precursor erythroid cells. Now how is this adherence possible? It will be by the presence of numerous adhesion molecules. So both on the macrophage and on the erythroid precursors. So you have alpha 4 beta 1 integrin, erythroblast macrophage protein, and intercellular adhesin molecule on the erythroblast, and alpha 5 integrin on the macrophages. Why is this important? It ensures that these erythroid cells are not prematurely released into the peripheral blood circulation before their complete maturation. So second function is that this macrophages can itself, you know, regulate erythropoiesis. It can produce various factors, both which suppress erythropoiesis and also which promote erythropoiesis. So factors like insulin-like growth factor, erythroid burst promoting activity, all this can be produced by the central macrophage, and it will promote erythropoiesis. And one other feature of this erythroblastic island is that it is capable of migrating towards the bone marrow sinusoids. You know that once the migration happens, the erythroid cells are released through the bone marrow sinusoids into the peripheral circulation. So these erythroid islands have a capacity to migrate towards the sinuses as the erythroid precursors mature. One another function is the phagocytosis of the expelled nuclei. That is also a function of this macrophage. Now, coming to the erythropoiesis per se, as already said, it starts with the megakaryocyte erythrocyte progenitor, and it differentiates into the lineage-specific erythroid precursors, so erythroid progenitors. So, which is the first lineage-specific erythroid progenitor? It is the burst-forming unit erythroid. So, this burst-forming unit erythroid and the colony-forming unit erythroid, these two are the lineage-specific progenitors in the development of the RBCs. And from there on, you have the precursors, starting from the pro-erythroblast to the erythroblastic orthochromatic erythroblast. So, you have the progenitors, which are lineage-specific, BFU and CFUE, and the precursors starting from pro-erythroblast to the orthochromatic erythroblast. Okay. Now coming to the progenitors, which are the two progenitors, you have the burst-forming unit erythroid and the colony-forming unit erythroid. So what is the peculiarity? You know, we won't be able to recognize them morphologically in the bone marrow. So instead, how do you recognize them? We recognize them by their ability, by their functional ability to form different erythroid colonies. So in culture, in vitro culture, in semi-solid media, these erythroid pinnators will form different sort of erythroid clusters or colonies. So here you have the burst forming unit erythroid. This is the earliest erythroid progenitor. It gives rise to, you know, this large erythroid colony with various satellite colonies like this. So this is a colony formed by a burst forming unit erythroid. And it's because, and this produces this large colony because it has a very high proliferative potential. Maturing from the burst forming unit erythroid, you have the colony forming unit erythroid. Now coming to this, it is more mature than the burst forming unit erythroid, but it has a small proliferative capacity. So in vitro media, it produces only smaller colonies of around 8 to 32 erythroblasts. Now, why is this? What is the importance of this colony forming unit? Now, this colony forming unit is the most erythropoietin sensitive cell. It carries the highest number or the highest density of erythropoietin receptors on its surface, and it is absolutely dependent on erythropoietin for its survival. So, and it is the same is being, you know, expanded whenever there is an additional need of hematopoiesis or erythropoiesis in the body. It is the colony forming unit that is going to expand markedly whenever we need to increase the erythropoiesis. The formation of this erythroblast, that is adhesion to this macrophages, also occurs during this stage of maturation. Now coming to the precursors. Now it is these stages which we are able to identify morphologically in the bone marrow. So first you have this pronormoblast, then which matures into the basophilic normoblast. Then you have the polychromatic normoblast, then which matures into this autochromatic normoblast, after which the nucleus is extruded and it forms the reticulocyte, and finally matures into the mature red blood cell. Now, just like as you see in this picture, you see what are the changes that is happening. You have the size is, you know, gradually decreasing from the pronormoblast to the red blood cell. So pronormoblast is a larger cell there. It is around 20 microns in diameter. You know, and mature RBC is just 7 to 8 microns in diameter. And come look at the nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. It is, you know, around 8:1 when it is a pronormoblast. While when it comes to orthochromatic normoblast, the cytoplasm is larger. It reverses. The NC ratio reverses into 1:2. And functionally, what happens, you know, this in the stages of pronormoblast and basophilic normoblast, the cytoplasm content predominantly consisting of RNA and ribosomes. So that is why the cytoplasm of these precursor cells are basophilic, because of taking the basic stains. They actually, in hemoglobin synthesis starts from this pronormoblast stage, but still the amount is very less and we are not able to stain it. And also there is a perinuclear Golgi unstained area. Sorry. Okay, then. And coming, then the next developmental stage is the polychromatic erythroblast. So by this stage, you know, we are able to recognize the presence of hemoglobin in the cytoplasm. So the staining will be a mixture of pink and blue, acidophilic and basophilic combined staining, and we have this around this blue-gray cytoplasm is seen in this polychromatic normoblast. And finally, the full component of hemoglobin develops by this stage, and it is salmon pink in color. And coming to the nuclear features, nucleoli. This nucleus is open, has open chromatin, and around 1-2 nucleoli is seen in the pronormoblast stage. But after that, the nucleus, you know, starts condensing, and because of the formation of heterochromatin, a nucleoli will no longer be visible. And by the time it reaches the orthochromatic nucleus, will be like pycnotic, entirely heterochromatin. It will be pycnotic, and it is time for the nucleus to be extruded. And coming to the divisions and cell divisions, the capacity to divide is only present till the stage from pronormoblast to the polychromatic normoblast, and it takes around 3-5 mitotic divisions occurs between the stages. From the orthochromatic normoblast, it's not able to divide, which is not able to undergo mitosis. So from a simple pronomoplast, around 8 to 32 mature red cells are derived, because around 3 to 5 mitotic divisions are possible between these stages. And what is the time it takes for a cell to mature from a pronomoplast to a mature RBC? It takes around 21 days. In fact, it is a long time it takes. That is, for the cell to mature from a burst forming unit to colony forming unit takes around 1 week. Roughly 1 week for it to CFU to mature to pronomoblast, and again roughly 1 week for the precursors to mature into the RBCs. So totally it takes around 21 days for the RBCs to form from the burst forming units. And one important point is that the number of cell divisions and the ultimate erythrocyte size is something that is determined by the hemoglobin concentration and the rate of hemoglobin synthesis in the RBC. So that is one of the reasons you have, in iron deficiency anemia, you see microcytic cells, because the hemoglobin concentration reaches the critical level only very slowly. So the precursors continue to divide and thus reducing the size of the mature RBCs. Now coming to the erythroblast enucleation, now this is an active process. It occurs during the orthochromatic stage of the normoblast. And it is an active process carried out by something known as the cytoplasmic actin ring that is formed by the association of F-actin that is present in the cytoplasm of orthochromatic normoblast. Now this F-actin will associate and form the cytoplasmic actin ring, and that will push, it will accumulate between the nucleus and the cytoplasm of the normoblast, and it will push the nucleus out. So as this nucleus goes out, it will carry along with it a small portion of the cytoplasmic membrane and some amount of cytoplasm. And what is there on the cytoplasmic membrane? The phosphatidyl serine will be exposed on the plasma membrane, and this will be detected by the macrophage in the erythroblastic island. So once the nucleus is extruded from the orthochromatic normoblast, we get the reticulocyte. Now this reticulocyte will undergo maturation for about 1 to 2 days in the bone marrow, thereafter 1 day in the peripheral blood before it forms the mature RBCs. So what happens during the maturation of the reticulocytes? So after nuclear extrusion also, this reticulocyte still have some, mitochondria, some amount of ribosomes and Golgi apparatus will be present in the reticulocytes. So as they mature, it starts losing these organelles one by one. So the polyribosomes, the earliest organelle to lose is the mitochondria. It will be removed by autophagy. Thereafter, the ribosomes, from the polyribosomes, they transform into monoribosomes. And thereafter, they are further degraded by the ribonucleases into the oligonucleotides and finally into nucleotides. As the ribosomes, when the RNA will be lost, and also there will be changes in the surface area and volume. Around 20% of the surface area will be lost, and around the volume, cell volume will decrease by around 10 to 15%. So also, the reticulocyte in the peripheral blood, it spends time in the spleen. And what happens in the spleen? The splenic macrophages, will function to remove any inclusions that is present remaining in the reticulocyte. Like if there is a nuclear remnant, it will be removed by the splenic macrophages. In addition, the membrane will be polished by these splenic macrophages. And finally, what we get is the biconcave discoid mature RBCs. Now coming to the factors which regulate erythropoiesis. Now there are several factors regulate erythropoiesis, including the colony stimulating factors, interleukins, stem cell factors, insulin growth factors. The most important factor that regulates erythropoiesis is the erythropoietin. Now this erythropoietin is the most important stimuli for the production of erythropoietin, that is hypoxia. Now, this hypoxia, whenever there is hypoxia, it could be either because of anemia or because of any external factors. Whenever there is hypoxia, it is detected by the peritubular interstitial cells in the kidney. They then produce erythropoietin. So, normally in a steady state erythropoiesis, the amount of erythropoietin will not fluctuate much. Only whenever there is a need for, rapid production of many RBCs at a time, that the production of erythropoietin is ramped up. Now coming to erythropoietin, What is erythropoietin? It is a thermostable, non-dialysable glycoprotein hormone. And how does it act? It acts through the erythropoietin receptor. Now, what is erythropoietin receptor? It is a transmembrane protein homodimer with extracellular and cytoplasmic domains. Now, which are the cells which has a maximum erythropoietin receptors? It is the stage between, as already told, is a colony forming unit. Erythroid is the most important cell which has the maximum number of erythropoietin receptors. Thereafter, from the stage of the proerythroblast, the amount of erythropoietin receptors gradually disappears. In that, erythroreticulocytes and red cells, the erythropoietin receptors are no longer expressed. Now, how does the erythropoietin act? So, erythropoietin acts through this, as already said, it acts through this erythropoietin receptor, which is a homodimer. And on the cytoplasmic side of the erythropoietin receptor, you have this JAK2 tyrosine kinase. So, whenever erythropoietin binds to the erythropoietin receptor, there will be a conformational change of this erythropoietin receptor and it will activate this tyroxine kinase, JAK2 tyrosine kinase will be activated, which will phosphorylate and activate several downstream signaling pathways. So, which are the downstream signaling pathways which are activated, which includes the STAT5 pathway, PI3KAT pathway, the RAS-RAF MAP kinase pathway, all these will be activated once erythropoietin binds to the erythropoietin receptor. So, what happens when these signaling pathways are activated? The transcription of genes will be activated. The most important is the GATA1. You have the anti-apoptotic molecules, the transferrin receptors, all these transcription of these genes will be activated. And what is the mechanism? So, what are all the changes which happens when by the action of erythropoietin? So, most important, we already said the most important cell which is receptive to erythropoietin is the colony forming unit erythroid. So, one action of erythropoietin is that it will prevent the apoptosis of colony forming unit and it expands the pool of colony forming unit. And then it will cause transcription of anti-apoptotic molecule, that is BCL-XL, and cause suppression of the Fas ligand mediated apoptosis in erythroblast. Another action is that it will accelerate the cell cycle. It will reduce the number of cell cycle and it will accelerate the processes involved during erythropoiesis. So, as already said, you know, the time it takes for the erythrocyte to form from the burst forming unit is around 21 days. Now, when we need a demand for RBCs, you know, we cannot wait all these 21 days for the new red blood cells to be formed. So, one is that by expanding the colony forming unit pool, it can act. And second is by accelerating all the cell processes. That by that way, you know, by the RBC start forming in 1 to 2 days by the action of erythropoietin. So this again is one of the reasons why, you know, whenever there is a hemolysis or hemorrhage, the newly formed red cells are seen to be large. They are macrocytes. This is because of the reduced cell divisions and acceleration of the process of erythropoiesis. The other actions are that it will increase the width of the spaces through which the RBCs egress into the sinus. It also causes down regulation of various, you know, adhesive molecules by which these precursors are adhered to the bone marrow stroma, such as fibronectin. Now, this is erythropoiesis, are the main features of erythropoiesis. Now, coming to the RBC proper. So, what is RBC? The normal human erythrocyte. It is a biconcave disc. It has a diameter of around 7 to 8 microns. And these are the normal RBC parameters in adult blood. This, we all know the mean MCV is between 79 to 98. The corpuscular hemoglobin of concentration of hemoglobin is also tightly regulated between 27 to 32 MCH and 32 to 36 MCHC. Okay. Now, what is the peculiarity of RBCs when you compare it with other eukaryotic cells? One is that it lacks nucleus, it lacks mitochondria, it lacks ribosomes. So, it's not able to divide, it cannot undergo mitosis, it cannot synthesize any new proteins, it cannot undergo any oxidative reactions that, you know, that happens in the mitochondria. But still, it is capable of living around 120 days in the blood. And majority of the content of RBC is a single protein. 95% of the cytoplasmic content is hemoglobin. Well, the rest 5%, you have the various enzymes and cofactors and other molecules, you know, are present. And it is capable of an efficient gas exchange. That is a primary function of RBCs, to transport oxygen and carbon dioxide between the lungs and the tissues. And more importantly, a very important feature of RBCs is the extreme deformability and the ability to withstand very high shear stress in the microcirculation. Now, the size of the RBC is around 7 to 8 microns, but when you compare it with the size of many of the capillaries and the splenic sinuses, it is around 2 microns. So, the RBCs need to be extremely deformable, and it has to withstand high shear stress for it to survive. So, how is this possible? How is RBCs made to be capable of this? So, three features of RBCs which help in the deformability of RBCs. One is that it has a biconcave shape. So, what is the advantage of a biconcave shape? The RBCs will have a very high surface area to volume ratio. So, even if it has to squeeze through the small pores, it has an excess redundant surface area is available for the RBCs to squeeze through the minute capillaries. Second factor which helps in the deformability of RBCs is the cytoplasmic viscosity. That is determined by the mean corpuscular hemoglobin concentration. So we already saw that, you know, we have the MCV is all maintained in a very high range, you know, from 70 to 90. But MCHC is always maintained in a very narrow range. Now, that is very important, because if the MCHC rises, so either because of any dehydration or in hereditary spherocytosis, the MCHC rises. So what happens? The cytoplasmic viscosity will increase and the RBC will become less deformable. And the third important peculiarity of the third important feature that results in this deformability is the membrane mechanical stability of RBCs, which we will be seeing now. About the membrane features. So, membrane of RBC, it's composed of predominantly protein and lipids in roughly equal proportions, and carbohydrates around 8%. And what is a membrane predominant central feature is the lipid bilayer, phospholipid bilayer with intercalated cholesterol. And within this phospholipid bilayer, there are the proteins. So, coming to the lipid component, you have, this is the phospholipid bilayer, this is the outer leaflet and this is the inner leaflet. These phospholipids, you have the head, hydrophilic heads will be facing the outside, while the hydrophobic tails will be hidden inside the bilayer. And this is the cholesterol. Cholesterol is intercalated between these phospholipids. The amount of phospholipids and cholesterol is in roughly equal proportions, and it has to be maintained so, because any disturbance in the proportion of these will cause RBC abnormalities. Now, coming to the phospholipids in the leaflets, now that is also asymmetrically maintained. That is, predominant phospholipids in the outer membrane or the outer leaflet of the RBC are the phosphatidylcholine and sphingomyelin. And predominant phospholipids on the inner leaflet of the RBC membrane are the phosphatidyl serine and phosphatidyl ethanolamine. So, how is this maintained? By active membrane transporters known as the flipases and the flopases. Then you have about, this is about glycolipids, around 5% glycolipids are also present. Now, what is the function of this cholesterol? This cholesterol will interact with this phospholipids and it will create an intermediate gel state for the membrane. So, what happens when this normal asymmetric arrangement of this phospholipids on the red cell membrane is disturbed? So, in case of beta lipoproteinemia, you know, there is a ratio of sphingomyelin compared to lecithin is increased in the outer leaflet. So, what happens? The outer leaflet will expand because the sphingomyelin concentration is more than the lecithin. So, the outer leaflet will expand and tiny spikes starts appearing, resulting in acanthocytes. Again, the same thing happens in liver disease. There will be increased membrane cholesterol in the outer leaflet. Again, the outer leaflet will expand and form acanthocytes, resulting in sparsal anemia in liver disease. In liver disease, another change is that there will be a balanced increase in phospholipids and cholesterol, and that causes the development of target cells. In a sickle cell anemia, when the phosphatidyl serine gets exposed on the outer leaflet, it will accelerate the apoptosis of the red cells. Now, another feature of this membrane is the ability of lateral mobility. This cholesterol and the phospholipids are able to move along the membrane, you know, laterally. So what is the importance of that? So whenever, you know, when this RBC is, you know, when they pass through this microcirculation, there's a chance that some amount of membrane might be pinched off. But because of this ability of this cholesterol and the lipids to move laterally, it can rapidly reseal the membrane before the cytoplasmic contents are released into the blood. And how is this concentration of these lipids and cholesterol maintained in the RBC membrane? You know that RBCs have no synthetic machinery. It cannot synthesize the phospholipids or the cholesterol. Then how is it maintained? It is maintained through exchange from the plasma cholesterol and lipids. Now coming to the important membrane proteins. So there are numerous membrane proteins on the RBC membrane, which include transmembrane proteins that, you know, it extend through the entire thickness of the phospholipid bilayer. Then there are these cytoskeletal proteins. The cytoskeletal proteins are present on the cytoplasmic side of the RBC membrane. Now these, both the transmembrane proteins and the cytoplasmic proteins, they are organized into multiple complexes. So two important complexes are the ankyrin complex and the junctional complex. Now what is the significance of these complexes? So it results in two types of interactions in the RBC membrane. So one is the vertical interactions, other is the horizontal interactions. So what, there is a vertical interactions occurring between these ankyrin complex and the junctional complex. So what is the importance of these vertical interactions? These vertical interactions will hold this phospholipid bilayer firmly to the cytoskeleton. It ensures that the membrane is stable, it doesn't get pinched off at any high shear stress. It will hold the phospholipid bilayer closely adherent to the cytoskeletal proteins. That is the function of this vertical interaction. So here you have the ankyrin complex between the band 3 glycophorin A for ankyrin and the spectrin tetramers, and the junctional complex between band 3 glycophorin C, GLUT1 and spectrin and actin filaments. And then you have the horizontal interactions. Now horizontal interactions occurs between this spectrin tetramers and the actin filaments and ankyrin. So spectrin tetramers, you know how they initially they organize into dimers, heterodimers. Alpha and beta chains of spectrin will organize to these spectrin dimers, which will self-associate, and they are forming the spectrin tetramers, which will associate with this actin filaments. Now, what is the importance of this horizontal interactions between them? Now, these interactions, you know, function like a spring. So in under conditions when the red cell need to, you know, flex and deform, these interactions between these molecules, you know, it can expand and contract and giving the flexibility to the RBC membrane. So this is the undersurface of the RBC. When you see it in a three-dimensional way, you can see that these protein complexes are organized into hexagons. The arms are formed by the spectrin and ankyrin, you know, which acts like a spring. It can expand and contract and give the flexibility to the RBCs. And these junctions are formed by the junctional complexes. Now coming to the most important protein within the RBCs, there is a hemoglobin. It constitutes 95% of the protein of the RBCs. So the type of hemoglobin changes with the gestation age and after birth. So intrauterine, the predominant globin chain that is formed is the zeta and the epsilon globin chains. So as a result, the predominant hemoglobins during the intrauterine early embryogenesis are the Gower and the Portland. Now after that, by about the 8 to 9 weeks, the gamma chain synthesis, gamma globin chain synthesis gradually increases. So as a result, in the rest of the fatal period, the predominant hemoglobin formed is the hemoglobin F, that is formed by alpha 2 and gamma 2. So even at birth, the predominant hemoglobin, around 90%, is the hemoglobin F, formed by alpha 2 and gamma 2. But by this time, the beta chain synthesis has also increased. So around 10 to 40% is also the adult hemoglobin. Now, and by 2 years of age, so after birth, since birth, the formation of synthesis of gamma globulin gradually decreases and the beta globulin synthesis gradually increases. And finally, by around 2 years of age, the predominant hemoglobin becomes a hemoglobin A, which is a tetramer of alpha 2 beta 2 globin chains. And also a small proportion of hemoglobin A2 is also formed, which is combination of alpha 2 and delta 2 globin chains. And around 1 to 2% is the hemoglobin F, that is alpha 2 gamma 2. So this change occurs because of the changes in the production of these globin chains. Now coming to the structure of hemoglobin. Now this is the quaternary structure of hemoglobin and this is the tertiary structure of hemoglobin. So what do you see? It is a hemoglobin is a spherical molecule. And what is this? Is adult hemoglobin. What is it composed of? Two alpha chains and two beta chains. Now these associate and with associated with each globin chain you have a heme group. And what is the component of heme? It is composed of the iron in ferrostate and a protoporphyrin ring. So each hemoglobin molecule has four heme groups attached and two alpha chains and two beta chains in the adult hemoglobin. So this is the tertiary structure of hemoglobin. You can see that these are the, you know, this numbered A, B, C is the helices of the hemoglobin molecule, which is the secondary structure of hemoglobin molecule. This A, B, C, these are the alpha helices. Now these alpha helices will, you know, loop and fold over one another and form this tertiary structure of hemoglobin or the globin molecule. And it is the heme group is residing in this pocket that is formed between the E and the F helices of globin chain. This heme group is present in each of the globin chains in this position. Now, how is hemoglobin formed? First, heme is formed, which will be in the mitochondria. In fact, heme synthesis occurs both in the mitochondria and in the cytosol, partly in the mitochondria and partly in the cytosol. And once heme is formed, the main enzyme is allosynthetase. And finally, when protoporphyrin is formed, iron is added to this protoporphyrin ring by ferrochelatase, and this results in the formation of heme. And this heme is transported to the cytoplasm and there it will combine with the alpha and the non-alpha polypeptide chains, or the non-alpha and non-alpha globin chains, which are synthesized by the ribosomes in the cytoplasm. And they will combine, heme and this non-alpha chain and the heme and alpha chain will combine and form first a dimer, and two dimers will combine and form the hemoglobin tetramer. Now coming to the next feature of RBCs, one is the most important one is the membrane permeability. Now this, you know that RBCs, you know, they're rapidly flowing in a fluid medium in our blood. So it's very important that it maintain the water and the solute homeostasis. It has to maintain a high potassium within the cell, low sodium and a low calcium content within the cell. So how does it do that? So on the membrane surface, there are several active transporters, various passive gradient channels are present by which it maintains the water and solute homeostasis. So the most important, you have the sodium potassium ATPase, which will pump 3 sodium ions outside and take up 2 potassium ions inside. You have the calcium ATPase, calmodulin activated calcium ATPase, which functions to pump the calcium out, thus protecting the cell from any harmful effects of calcium. You have third channel is a GARDOS channel, which, you know, it responds into increased intracellular calcium levels by selective loss of potassium. Then there are these anion channels. The most important is the BAN3 or the anion exchanger 1, which is involved in the exchange of chloride and bicarbonate anions. Water is easily transported by the aquaporin. And glucose is taken up by the glucose transporter, GLUT1. Now coming to the next topic, that is the RBC metabolism. Now we know that RBC doesn't have mitochondria, so it is not able to generate energy by a aerobic process. So 90% of its energy requirements is through the anaerobic channel, that is through the anaerobic glycolysis, by converting glucose to pyruvic acid. So in that process, it gains two ATP molecules. And why does RBC need this energy for? You know, it has to maintain the skeletal protein deformity. It has to maintain the cation channels. You know, the active channels are there on the membrane. They should be maintained. It should protect the proteins and the hemoglobin from oxidant stress. So for all these functions, RBCs require energy, and majority, 90% of the energy is obtained by anaerobic glycolysis. In addition to the primary path, it has several shunt pathways also act in the RBC. So they are called shunt pathways because they are pathways which originate as shunts or diversion from the primary glycolytic pathway. So these diversions have specific functions. So the three main diversion pathways or the shunt pathways are the hexose monophosphate pathway, the methemoglobin reductase pathway, and the Rappaport-Leubering pathway. So what is the function of hexose monophosphate pathway? It protects the RBC from any oxidant stress. What is the function of methemoglobin reductase pathway? It will reduce any methemoglobin that is formed. So what is methemoglobin? You know that in the hemoglobin, it can transport oxygen only when the iron is in the ferrous form. So when the iron gets oxidized to the ferric form, we say it is the methemoglobin. So that methemoglobin has got a very low affinity for oxygen. So whenever a methemoglobin is formed, it should be immediately converted back to the ferrous form. So for that, you have the methemoglobin reductase pathway. And you have the Rappaport-Leubering pathway, that is for producing the 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate. And which we will say what is the function of 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate. So first coming to the first shunt pathway, that is hexose monophosphate shunt pathway. So as already said, the function of this pathway is that the aim is to degrade any oxidant stress. Any oxidant, reactive oxygen species are formed, it should be immediately degraded. Now how is that done? It is by the continuous supply of a reducing agent, that is reduced glutathione. This reduced glutathione will detoxify hydrogen peroxide by the action of glutathione peroxidase. And how does the RBC ensure that there is a continuous supply of this reducing agent? By producing NADPH as the shunt pathway. Through the shunting of glucose-6-phosphate into the hexose monophosphate pathway, the RBC is able to generate NADPH. And now this NADPH acts as a reducing equivalent, and it will reduce oxidized glutathione to reduced glutathione. And it is this reduced glutathione through the action of glutathione peroxidase which will detoxify the oxidant radicals. So what happens when, why do you have to detoxify these oxidant, reactive oxidant species? Because in the presence of this oxidant stress, all the, you know, the lipid membrane can be degenerated, the hemoglobin can get transformed to methemoglobin, the enzymes will get inactive. So this, for protecting the cell from such damages, any oxidant radicals which are formed should be immediately detoxified, and hexose monophosphate shunt pathway acts for that. So a major enzyme in this pathway is this glucose-6-phosphate dehydrogenase. So we know that whenever there is a mutation or deficiency of this G6PD, you know, it results in hemolysis. Now coming to the next shunt pathway, that is the methemoglobin reductase. So we already said that the RBC is protected from any oxidant stress by the HMB pathway. But even then, some amount of hemoglobin, the ferrous iron, is routinely, it will be oxidized to the ferric form in spite of the presence of an HMB pathway. So in such cases, you know, when if iron is in ferric state in methemoglobin, it cannot transport oxygen and the RBC will not be able to function normally. So any methemoglobin is formed in the RBC, it should be immediately reduced to the ferrous form. And that is done by this methemoglobin reductase pathway. And it uses the NADH that is formed during the conversion of glucose 3-phosphate to 1,3-bisphosphoglycerate in the glycolytic pathway. So again, by shunting glucose 3-phosphate, NADH is produced, and that is used in the reduction of methemoglobin back to the ferrous form. Now coming to the last pathway, you have the 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate shunt. So as the name suggests, the aim is to produce 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate. And what is the need for 2,3-bisphosphoglycerate in RBC? This 2,3-BPG will bind to the globin and reduce the affinity for oxygen of the hemoglobin. So as a result, it will help in shifting the oxygen dissociation curve to the right, and it will enhance the delivery of oxygen to the tissues. Now coming to the last topic, that is the erythrocyte turnover. So we have completed how the RBCs are formed and about the various normal functional and structural features of RBCs. Now finally coming to the erythrocyte turnover. So normally, you know, the RBCs have a lifespan of about 120 days. And 90% of the normal RBC destruction occurs extravascularly, where predominantly in the spleen and a lesser extent in the liver and bone marrow. And usually the senescent erythrocytes, there's the aged erythrocytes, you know, they are usually minimally damaged and they are preferentially removed in the spleen. But in case the RBCs have got severe red cell damage due to any sort of hemoglobin abnormalities or membrane abnormalities, such severely damaged red cells are predominantly destroyed in the liver because of the greater blood flow. And this process, this extravascular hemolysis or the erythrophagocytosis, you know, it's an extremely efficient process. That is, around every second, around 5 million erythrocytes are phagocytosed by the macrophages of the reticular endothelial system. And around 10% of the normal destruction of RBCs occur intravascularly. Now, how does the body know when an RBC is aged? So what are the changes which occur to the RBC during the aging process? So as the RBCs age, you know, the enzymes, predominantly the glycolytic enzymes, you know, it will start reducing its function. So what happens because of that? The production of ATP will reduce. So we know that glycolysis is a major, 90% of the energy requirements the cell RBC gets through glycolysis. So when glycolytic enzymes are lost, the ATP supply is compromised. So then most of the functional characteristics of RBCs will be disturbed. That is, it will the membrane and the hemoglobin will be exposed to oxygen damage. The function of all the membrane pumps will be disturbed. So because of all of this, there will be a loss of deformability of RBCs. The membrane deformability will reduce because of the decreased energy supply in the RBC. So what happens when there is reduced deformability? The RBCs will get trapped in the minute spaces in the splenic sinuses, and it will be erythrophagocytosed. So there is a one major way in which these RBCs become senescent. So there are additional ways are also there. That is, because of the decreased activity of ATP in the membrane, when we discussed about the membrane, we said that, you know, the normal asymmetric distribution of the phospholipids in the membrane is maintained by these active transporters, fructases and proteases. So when the ATP production is decreased, the activity of these membrane transporters will be disturbed. So what happens? The phosphatidyl serine, which normally exists on the inner leaflet of the membrane, will get exposed on the outer leaflet. And this phosphatidyl serine on the outer leaflet is an eat me signal. That is, the macrophages readily recognizes these red cells and phagocytose them. And additionally, there is a decrease in something called the don't eat me signals. One example is the CD47. And one another mechanism by which the cells age is, you know, by the oxidant stress. The oxidant stress in the RBC will cause the oxidation of heme to a substance called the hemichromes. These hemichromes will bind to the BAN3. You know, BAN3 is a transmembrane protein on the RBC membrane. It is an anion exchange protein which exchanges chloride and bicarbonate. Now, this BAN3 protein, the hemichrome will bind to this BAN3 and cause clustering of this BAN3. And when these BAN3 clusters, it will expose a new antigen, or a new antigen. And now this new antigen will induce autoantibodies in the body. And when these autoantibodies bind to these BAN3 clusters, it will act as an opsonin. And the phagocytes can readily recognize them and phagocytose these RBCs. Now, just this is what happens in the splenic circulation. Now, this is a splenic circulation. You have the pencillate arterioles coming here, opening into the sinusoids, and thereafter the venous circulation starts. About 90% of the splenic circulation is closed circulation, like this, but about 10% of the splenic circulation occurs through the open method, that is, open circulation. So, here the RBC, the blood is, you know, it is dumped into the parenchyma of the spleen. So how does then this blood go back into the vasculature? It has to go through the endothelial cells of the splenic sinusoids. So normally it can easily pass directly in the closed circulation, but through the open circulation, these RBCs will have to squeeze through the endothelial cells lining the splenic sinusoids. So this is the morphology of the splenic sinusoids. What you see here, these elongated structures are the endothelial cells. And you can see that there is a very small space, around 2 micron space is always present between these endothelial cells. So when the RBCs have to get back into the vasculature, it has to extremely deform and squeeze through these small spaces. So in an aged RBC, this extreme deformability is lost. So what happens? It will be trapped here between these spaces, between the endothelial cells, and it will be rapidly recognized by the resident macrophages in the spleen and phagocytosed. So what happens once the RBC is phagocytosed? So all the components will be degraded. So you have the hemoglobin will be degraded into the amino acids, and it will enter the amino acid pool. The heme, you know, it is composed of the protoporphyrin ring and iron. So it will be degraded into free iron, and the protoporphyrin ring will be degraded by the enzyme heme oxygenase, microsomal heme oxygenase, into biliverdin within the macrophage. And biliverdin will be converted by biliverdin reductase into bilirubin in the spleen. So this bilirubin is unconjugated. So this unconjugated bilirubin will be transported to the liver by albumin, in combination with albumin. There it will be conjugated and excreted. And what happens to the iron that is formed? The iron will be stored as ferritin, and it will be exported into the plasma by ferroportin, and finally for erythropoiesis it is transported to the bone marrow by transferrin. Now this is the extravascular hemolysis. So all the contents are somehow the body tries to return back into the body itself in extravascular hemolysis. Now, but what happens in around 10% of cases, 10% of the death of RBCs, senescent RBCs, occurs by intravascular hemolysis. So what happens there? There the hemoglobin is released directly into the circulation. But even then, the body has a mechanism by which, you know, it will somehow conserve whatever iron it has. So what does the body do? This hemoglobin, when it is in the circulation, it forms this, is degrades into these dimers, alpha beta dimers. So this body produces a protein that is haptoglobin by the liver. It will immediately combine with these dimers of hemoglobin before it can get excreted through the kidney. It will combine with these dimers. And what happens to this haptoglobin-hemoglobin complex? It is taken into the liver. And there in the macrophages and in the parenchymal cells of the liver, the same process that happens in extravascular hemolysis happens. So thus the iron and the amino acids are all returned back into the body. But even then, when there is a massive hemolysis, intravascular hemolysis, what happens is haptoglobin is overwhelmed. So some amount of dimers will still be present as free hemoglobin in the blood. So now this dimers, you know, they can easily pass through the kidney, glomeruli can get filtered through the kidney, and so it results in hemoglobinuria. But even then, body still tries to conserve the iron by another mechanism. That is, once the free hemoglobin is there in the blood, it gets oxidized to methemoglobin. And from methemoglobin, the heme is released. And another protein called hemopexin will now combine with the heme. And this hemopexin-heme complex is taken back to the liver. Again, the same process of extravascular hemolysis occurs here, and the iron and the amino acid contents are brought back into the body. So only a very small portion will be excreted through the kidney. So this is the how the intravascular hemolysis also occurs. So that's all with the erythrocyte turnover.
Wonderful. You are a really good teacher.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, you really taught so well and so calm. Slight initial hiccup because of the net, I think.
Yes,
but
yes.
But otherwise, the whole thing was very nice. Very smooth.
Thank you.
Very nicely done. Wow. And this topic is, it has been presented in such a nice way that, you know, just by listening to the entire lecture, one can understand every bit of it, you know, from right from the erythropoiesis to the erythrodestruction and how it's preserved across the system. Wonderful, wonderful. Brilliant. Dr. Jayapriya, you've done a wonderful job.
Thank you.
Wow. Yeah, and you're very calm. You teach very well. Very cool. Brilliant. And let me see if there are any questions on the YouTube. Yeah, there are no questions on the YouTube. Please share the PDF of your presentation.
Okay.
We'd like to have you here back again with the next presentation. Wonderfully presented. Very calm, very smooth, very crisp and very clear. Wonderful
thank
concept.
You.
Thank you so much. God bless you. Take care. Good night. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Good night.
Bye. Take care.
Bye.